The other complaint I have about this book is that I could not care less about Kate and Jack's relationship. Hey, welcome to my channel. My name is Jessie, and today we are doing my February wrap-up video. Before we get started, first, I want to remind you to please like this video and subscribe if you're interested in seeing more of my content. Subscribing will make finding my content on Tuesdays and every other Thursday a little bit easier. I also want to say you may notice that the background is a little different, and that's because I rearranged my bedroom a little bit, so I'm going to be playing with where the best place to put the camera is for a little bit now. Anyways, in February I read 9 books. I kind of wanted to get to 10 because I also read 10 books in January, so it kind of would have been nice to get to like 2 months with nice even numbers that added up to nice and even 20. I really enjoyed almost everything I read, and most of the books I read actually had really high ratings. Of the 9 books I read, 7 of them were physical books and 2 were ebooks, but there were like I think 4 books that I also went back and forth with the audiobook as well, depending on, you know, if Rowan and I were walking or if I just didn't feel like physically reading. The first book I read in February was Concrete Rose by Angie Thomas, and I rated it 4 stars. Concrete Rose follows Maverick Carter, who is Star Carter's dad in The Hate U Give, and he's just found out he's a father. Now he's kind of got to decide what's the best way for him to take care of his family. He can either, you know, stay a member of the King Lord's gang, which his dad was originally a part of and he became a part of after his dad died, and he can sell drugs and, you know, make a decent bit of money, or he can distance himself from the gang and, you know, make a more honest living working at a grocery store. Throughout the book, you kind of follow him as he learns what will be the better decision for him, and he learns, you know, it's not just important to be a good dad who provides for your kid, it's also important to actually be there for your kid. My only complaint about this book is that I felt like almost everything that happens in the summary happens within the first 100 pages, and the rest of the book, while he's still trying to learn what would be a better option for him and what he needs to do as a father, it kind of feels like it just, the way it was written, I think wasn't as interesting for me, and that's kind of why Concrete Rose ended up being a 4-star read, but it was still a really good book and one I could see myself rereading. Next, I read Legendborn by Tracy Dion, and I read it as an ebook. It was a 5-star read for me, and for the first half of the month, it was my favorite read of February. Legendborn follows Bree in the aftermath of her mom's death. She is in an early college program a few hours away from home, and one night while leaving class or the dining hall or something, she sees a Legendborn student defeat some type of demon or something, and that kind of jogs a memory from the night her mom died. And so she ends up trying to join the Legendborn group as a squire, and it's a very elite group where most of the people who are part of the group, them or their families have been a part of the group in some way for a very long time. And by long time, I mean like generations. And so Bree's an outsider first because, you know, she has no family ties to the group that she knows of and that anyone knows of, but also because she's also the first Black person to try to be part of the group. And so she kind of also has to deal with like racism on the campus, including having like Confederate soldier statues along the campus as well. But as the book goes on, Bree, you know, learns more about who her mom really was, and then she learns more about who she really is. There's a love triangle, I think, that like, I don't mind. Normally I'm not a fan of love triangles, but this one I don't hate, and I honestly genuinely can't decide for sure which side I pick. The only complaint I have about this book is that it does have a fair bit to do with the King Arthur and the Round Table lore, because the Legendborn group descend from the original King Arthur and his Round Table. And I would say that you probably don't need like a super strong knowledge of King Arthur and the Round Table to enjoy this book. My knowledge is pretty weak. Mine only extends to like, you know, the 1980s or 1990s Quest for Camelot movie, the one with like the singing two-headed dragon that sings all the catchy songs throughout the book. But it was a really good book and I really enjoyed it, and it was my favorite for most of the month, so I'm going to call it my second favorite book of February. After that, I read Opposite of Always by Justin A. Reynolds, and I have a video book review over this book as well that I will have linked. This was a 3-star rating for me, and it was my least favorite read of the month. Opposite of Always follows Jack, who is a high school senior. He went to a college party after college day. He meets this girl named Kate, and over the course of a few months, he falls in love with her. I wouldn't say she has feelings for him, I would say, but I don't necessarily think she falls in love with him either. And after this period of months, Kate dies, and he enters the time loop, and it's determined that, you know, Kate is the one he has to save in order for the time loop to end. It was a fine book. It was okay. The main things that I got out of this book are, first, that I don't like time loops and I don't like time travel. Those elements are not for me. I read Again But Better by Christine Riccio, and I really didn't like that book. I wasn't for sure after reading that book if it was the time travel I didn't like, because there were plenty of other things I didn't like either. but this book confirmed that time travel is not for me. The other complaint I have about this book is that I could not care less about Kate and Jack's relationship. I was not a fan of their relationship. I did not care for them. I didn't really care if they ended up together or not, other than the fact that, you know, the time loop couldn't end until Jack, or until Kate at least lived, and it seemed like they had to be together for her to live. I don't know, I wasn't a fan. I could have done without Kate being a part of the story at all. I was much more interested in other relationships in the stories. I didn't hate it. I liked some parts, but I didn't love it all. And so it was an okay book. Next, I read When No One Is Watching by Alyssa Cole, and I rated this one 4 stars. This was a really good book. It was really interesting. And the scariest part about this book is that what happened has happened in some ways, and whatever like hasn't necessarily happened that we know of yet has all the potential in the world to happen, which is really scary. Before I went to this book, I wasn't quite sure what to expect out of it, because first, I think Alyssa Cole typically writes romance books. That's what I've heard a lot of other people say. That's kind of what I got from her Goodreads profile. And then also, this book was actually in the romance section of Barnes & Noble whenever I picked it up. However, I think this book is technically classified as a thriller. And I think some people who actually read thrillers say it doesn't quite read like a thriller. I don't read a lot of thrillers, so I was easily impressed. I think it may be a little bit more suspenseful than thrillery. I was still impressed and I still enjoyed it. This book follows Sydney and Theo. Sydney, her neighborhood is being gentrified. This is a neighborhood she has grown up in. She's lived in this neighborhood almost her whole life, except for a period of time whenever she was married and lived out of state. People in her neighborhood just kind of go missing. There are people who have always said they would never leave, but then circumstances are causing them to leave. Or if they are so adamant that they'll never leave, they just happen to disappear and it's explained away. But before that happens, or before she really catches on to that happening, she ends up trying to make a walking tour of the neighborhood to kind of like tell people the real history of the neighborhood and not the whitewashed version. And this guy named Theo ends up helping her. He's one of the people who moves to the neighborhood after it's starting to be gentrified. I will say that this book didn't focus on the walking tour as much as I thought it would. The walking tour did kind of, I guess, lead clues to what was happening or who was involved whenever the Sydney and Theo did their research. But overall, the walking tour wasn't as important as I thought it would be. It wasn't used as much as I was expecting it to be. This will be a spoiler. But anyways, at the end of the book, Sydney and Theo find out what's been happening to all their neighbors. And the scariest part is that this kind of stuff has happened in US history before, and certain aspects of it haven't happened before. For example, and this is a spoiler, you know, the Tuskegee syphilis trials, where a large group of black men were given syphilis and then were denied treatment so the US government could track them over like 40 years and see how syphilis affected people in the long term, and I'm assuming how, you know, it affected the other people around them and stuff. They find out, you know, people are being experimented on without, you know, consent. And it's like that scary because it's something that has happened before. I think that might be part of why this book worked, is because it's not, you know, something unnatural. It's not related to Sydney's mental health. Sydney's mental health is mentioned a few times because she's worried that, you know, she's imagining it all because she's been, I guess, gaslit in the past about her feelings. But overall, I really enjoyed this book. It was really interesting and it was very like thought-provoking, at least to me. Next, I read The Deep by River Solomon, and I rated this book 4 stars. This book follows Yetu. The Deep kind of takes place in this alternate universe where pregnant black women were thrown overboard slave ships and their babies were born in the water and immediately evolved into mermaids or sirens. And it's been a few like centuries or however long, it's been a while since that first happened. And now all the memories for the sirens are held by the historian. And in this case, it's Yetu. And Yetu is really burdened by the memories. Yetu has always been very sensitive to their surroundings and the emotions of others around them. And this has just kind of made things worse. And so during this particular ceremony where all the other sirens kind of have the memories for a certain amount of time and Yetu gets a break, Yetu leaves. Yetu ends up learning a lesson that essentially it's important for them to hold the memories, and the memories are important even no matter how painful they are. And so this was a really interesting book. It's really a small book, and I do think that I would have liked it a little bit better if it had been longer. I think I would have enjoyed it if it was a little bit longer. If it was written maybe more like a traditional novel and a little bit less like maybe a novella would be what it would be called based on the link, but it was interesting. After that, I was kind of in the mood for like more lighthearted and like fluffier reads, and so I wanted to read, I guess, more romantic comedy type books, which 2 of the next 3 books were romantic comedies. One of them I thought would be, but it wasn't. The next book I read was Get a Life, Chloe Brown by Talia Hibbert, and I read this book 4 stars as well. This book follows Chloe Brown. She has fibromyalgia, and it seems to have like affected how much she lives her life or how happy she is with some parts of her life. She has a near-death experience that kind of like makes her think she's not happy with how she's been living her life. So she makes a list of all the things she's going to do, and the first thing she does is move out. And so the book picks up a few months later. She's living in an apartment on her own, and she and this maintenance guy, the maintenance guy named Red, kind of have like a misunderstanding, and neither of them are really liking each other, even though, you know, Red's friendly with everyone. He's not particularly friendly with her at first, but they get to know each other, and she ends up bringing him on to work with her list. And along the way, they kind of develop feelings and fall in love. And there is a misunderstanding thing at the end, but I think it was fine. I like the way it was handled. So I think two important things about this book is first that, you know, it shows Chloe Brown, who has fibromyalgia. She has chronic illness. She has chronic pain. And I don't think I've read very many books that have a character who have a main character that has chronic illness or chronic pain. The closest book I can think of is Harper in A Curse So Dark and Lonely. I can't quite remember what she has, but she was born with a birth defect and it affects the way she walks. And so that book and Get a Life, Chloe Brown are the only books I can think of where, you know, the main character isn't, you know, close to perfect. And so I think that was really important. I do want to try to read more books that have characters who have either disabilities or chronic pain and fatigue and stuff like that. And then the other important thing I think this book mentions is that Red was previously in a relationship where he was emotionally abused by an ex-girlfriend. And I think that's important to mention as well, but I think it's especially important that, you know, both characters are trying to push themselves to be better versions of themselves, despite their circumstances, make things better for how they want to be, I guess. I don't know the best way to describe that, and I'm hoping I'm describing it well. But this is a really cute book, and I do hope to eventually pick up Get a Clue, Danny Brown, and Act Your Age, Eve Brown, hopefully sometime this year, because I'm excited to read those as well. The next book I read was Honey Girl by Morgan Rogers, which was a 5-star read and also my favorite book of both February and 2021 so far this year, which is kind of funny because I went into this book expecting something completely different. I expected it to be like a light, fluffy, sapphic romance, a little bit of comedy, lots of fluff, really light and sweet, and it was not like that at all. I don't know where I got the idea from. I'm still trying to figure that out, but it was the wrong idea. But everything still worked out. This book follows Grace Porter. She recently graduated with her PhD in astronomy, and she's getting ready for that next chapter in life. She's trying to find, you know, her job and move on and like kind of do everything that she's supposed to do. But things aren't quite working out, and she kind of is making out of character decisions, including going to Vegas and getting married, and then not remembering her wife after they get married. And so Grace goes back home from Vegas, and she tries to keep job hunting and stuff, and she kind of tells her dad, you know, I kind of need a break. Things are really tough right now, and I fucking need a break. I've been working at this degree for over a decade, and now I just want to take a break and relax and breathe. And her dad's like, Porters don't do that. And so like her dad's kind of overbearing and her mom's kind of absent, and she ends up lying and goes to spend a summer with her new wife in New York, and they get to know each other. And then in the end, Grace gets scared and runs away, more or less. So I think this book is really important, especially for people who have struggled with like, you know, one chapter of their life closing and going to another. I don't necessarily think this book will magically, you know, make you realize what you need to do or what you want. I just think it would be nice to have someone to commiserate with, as well as, you know, watch Grace kind of accept that she needs a break, accept that she doesn't have to please everyone, accept that she doesn't have to be happy with anyone but herself, and ask for help and learn how to ask for help, and that she can, you know, ignore the Porter motto sometimes. But I love this book, and it was such a good book. I definitely recommend you read it if you get a chance. After that, I read The Dating Plan by Sarah Desai, and this was a 3-star reading for me. It was an okay book. It was fine, but I didn't love it. And I honestly think I spoiled this book for myself by reading too many Instagram reviews of it. The majority of the reviews I saw were 3-star reviews that said it was a good book, but it wasn't great. And I think I internalized that, and it affected my feelings about the book. And I think I was more aware of like Daisy's fandom stuff than I would have been if I hadn't, you know, read reviews, or if I had read fewer reviews. This book follows Daisy and Liam. Daisy is at, you know, like some type of work convention meeting, I don't quite remember what, and she runs into this guy from her past named Liam. They knew each other when they were kids. He was her brother's best friend, and she kind of hates him now, but one of her aunts or something is there as well, and her aunt is like bringing this guy to push on her as a fiance because her family is worried that she's going to be old and alone because she hasn't married yet, and she's really not interested in marrying, but her family is just scared she's going to be alone for the rest of her life if she doesn't get married soon. And so she tells her aunt that she and Liam are engaged, even though they're not, and Then ultimately, they end up with a real fake engagement after Liam comes to her and he's like, hey, I got these tasks to complete that involve being married for at least a year in order to keep this family thing that I don't want to lose. I don't want to spoil the book. They end up working together. They kind of get to know each other. They kind of clear up what happened in the past. But then a few other issues, I think primarily on Liam's side, kind of pushes him away again at the end. But ultimately, he does have a happy ending. And this was a cute book and it was a sweet book. It just wasn't a book that I love. The final book I read in February was Raybearer by Jordan Fweku. I'm very sorry if I mispronounced the author's name. This was a 4-star rating for me. It was a really good book. It was so interesting. I always like to say I like fantasy, but I think I haven't read like a wide array of fantasy because this one wasn't quite like most of the fantasy I read. A lot of the fantasy books I read are more like Legendborn, where, you know, it's a more modern world, but there's like magic kind of hidden within it almost. I don't know if that'd be the best way to describe it or not, but this book follows Teresai and she has been born with the purpose of killing this prince. That is the whole reason her mom had her. That was the sole reason for her existence, essentially. Over time, she realizes she doesn't want to kill him, and so she decides to essentially forget her memories, but then they all come back and she's got to kind of work through that. I really don't know the best way to describe this book. I'm actually having a very hard time coming up with a way to describe this book in a way that makes sense that also doesn't, you know, tell you every single thing about the book and spoil it. Yeah, so I don't really know the best way to describe the book, but it was a good book. I will, I guess, tell you my complaints, and that might kind of tell you more about the book. My first complaint about Raybearer is that the pacing seems a little weird at the beginning. The pacing seems kind of rushed during the first half of the book because it feels like so much of the first half of the book is kind of setting up the backstory. The book starts when Teresai is 7, and she runs away from home and she's like ends up like with this creature called an Elugbato, and that creature kind of tells her the reason for her existence. He shows where her mom like essentially wished her into existence in some specific way. And then it picks up again where she's 11 and she is being sent to the palace to be raised with the prince and to have a chance at being a council member, to be one of the 11 council members with the prince, who she is tasked with killing whenever she's being sent away. Then after that, it picks back up whenever she's 14, I think. She's like 12 or 14, something, or she's about 14, I think. And something happens where she has to rescue someone, and then after she does, she erases her memories, and then it picks up again, and she's, I think, 15 or 16, and she's forgotten her memories. She's now a council member, and it's everything kind of seems to be okay until her memories are jogged, and she tries to carry out her mother's wish, and then she has to figure out how to fix everything. It's a lot going on to set all that up, but it is really interesting. But the pacing did feel a little weird to me at first. The other thing I didn't like as much is that there were a few elements of the book that were predictable. I predicted a couple of relationships that would happen. I predicted where a particular object might be. I predicted what was going to happen to a particular character. And I don't know how much of that, you know, was just, you know, Teresai, the book was told from her point of view. I don't know how much of that was, you know, just her not knowing but the reader's supposed to know versus how much of that was, you know, I'm an adult reading a YA book. So like, I don't know how much of that was, you know, me being an adult reading the book versus was that intent on showing through or what. So I did go ahead and like, that's why the book is rated 4 stars. But I think the world building is amazing. The whole idea of the magic system or being a Raybearer works was so interesting to me. And I do intend to read the second book when it comes out sometime this year. I'm hoping my library will get it on Libby since they had Raybearer on Libby. Anyways, those are all the books I read in February. Please let me know what you read in February or if you've read any of the books that I read. Thank you so much for taking the time to watch this video. I will talk to you on Tuesday. Bye.